Please get your King James Bibles and open it up to 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So, you know, if you live ungodly, you're not going to suffer any persecution. You know, if you say you believe in Jesus and you go to the bar and drink and swear and, you know, hey, you're one of the guys or one of the gals, as the case may be. This Bible study is going to be on suffering for Christ, suffering for the gospel, suffering for the word of God. Well, I tell you what, you turn on TBN and listen to Benny Hinn and that bunch, they'll tell you that, why, brother, if you're suffering, you just don't have enough faith. You know, they'll actually make you think that you're unsaved because God hasn't blessed you. Why, you need to send them some seed money, a tithe, and God will bless you. Yeah, send Benny Hinn some money so he can buy another Learjet. And God will bless you. God will bless you. And they hope that you never dust off that family Bible on your coffee table and read it. Let's go to the book of Psalms. We're going to do a little bit of Old Testament, then we're going to do New. Psalms chapter 9 and verse 13. King David, I believe. Have mercy upon me, O Lord. Consider my trouble which I suffer of them that hate me. Thou that liftest me up from the gates of death. You know, the New Testament, in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 21, you know, Christ was always an example unto us. He was God, and he became man. You know, a lot of people hate that doctrine. The Jehovah's Witnesses want to make Jesus a mere angel. And then there's the Muslims that say, well, God has no son. Well, I tell you what, you know why I stick with the King James? Let me read it to you. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14. These things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth, and without controversy. Great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. See, that puts the nail in the coffin of people that say, well, Jesus wasn't God. God has no son. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. When you read what the Bible says about Emmanuel, I mean, come on, people. And of course, the new Bible version promoters will say, well, you know, the King James got this all wrong. They don't know what they're talking about. In Isaiah 7 and verse 14, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son. and shall call his name Emmanuel. Now, what does that mean, Emmanuel? Well, that's answered in Matthew chapter 1 and verse 23. Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. God with us. Any plainer? Can it be any plainer than that? I don't think so. All right, the TV has been, and the movies for years, has been promoting that mankind can aspire to have godlike powers. You know, superheroes, DC Comics, Superman, Marvel Comics, you know, Thor, and all these other things. Lucy, wasn't that a TV or movie or whatever? So, it all goes back to the Garden of Eden, where the serpent, that old serpent, the devil and Satan, promised Eve, ye shall be as gods. So let's take a look at that real quick. Genesis chapter 3. I guess verse 1, right? It's always good to start at the beginning. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. So here it is, the first thing that Satan does, calls God a liar. And then what does he do? Verse 5. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, gods, knowing good and evil. You know, it's funny. Satan and the world, the movies, TV, what have you, they always teach that man can become as gods. But yet those same people will deny that God became man. God was manifest in the flesh. And why? Because after the fall of Adam, we were all corrupted with sin nature. There could be no perfect sacrifice. God, who was perfect, had to come, become, and be perfect to fulfill his own requirements for a perfect sacrifice. And if you don't understand what I'm talking about, you need to read your Bible. Turn your TV off. Matthew chapter 16 and verse 21. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Funny, it doesn't say he suffered many things of the Roman soldiers, and does it? No. It said of the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes. So, Let's read a little something in the Old Testament. Turn to Isaiah chapter 53. The more I take a look at Isaiah, the more, I don't know, the more I'm drawn to it. It's just, Isaiah just, it ties in just with the rest of the Bible and Revelation, the book of Revelation, the revealing so well. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 1. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. Who's this talking about? Christ. Verse 3. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. This is a chapter you will never hear a rabbi reading in the synagogue. Absolutely never. They avoid this verse like the bubonic plague. Verse 4. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. If you don't know what a stripe is, let me take a whip across your back and you will know what a stripe is. A lot of people don't, they say, oh, I don't understand the King James Bible. I need the new version. You mean the new version that says that, behold, a virgin shall conceive, where it just says a young woman? Well, guess what? 12-year-olds get pregnant. Is it miraculous birth? No. But that's what the new Bible versions say, a young woman. No, my Bible says a virgin shall conceive. Isaiah, verse 6. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him. Laid on who? Christ. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. What's iniquity? Sin. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, the sinless lamb. Jesus is called the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. You know, in the Quran, the Muslims will tell you that the Bible's wrong. Old Testament and New Testament. Oh, all wrong. All wrong, so read the words of Muhammad, whatever. And they will tell you that Isaac, Abraham was told by God to offer Isaac as a sacrifice. And Muslims say, oh, no, 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 no. That was Ishmael, who is considered the father of the Arabs. Now, in the Bible, Abraham took Isaac up to a mountain and was getting ready to sacrifice him. And he had the knife, he had the wood, but no lamb. And Isaac said, Father, Where's the sacrifice? Where's the animal? And in Genesis 22 and verse 8, we read the answer to that. And Abraham said, "My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering." So they went, both of them, together. And guess what? There was a ram caught in a thicket by the horns. And God stayed Abraham's hand to sacrifice Isaac. You know, in John chapter 1, in verse 29, we read, "The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and saith, Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." And then in John 1:36, "And looking upon Jesus as he walked, he saith, Behold, the Lamb of God." In Revelation 19 and verse 9, "And he saith unto me, Write, Blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, These are the true sayings of God." Go to Revelation chapter 13. I keep coming back to this chapter. I tell you what, this is coming, people. This is coming. I don't know when, but it's coming. Verse 1. "And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world wondered after the beast." That's right, all the world's going to wonder after the beast. "And they worshipped the dragon." That's going to be the world. "And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast. And they worshipped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him?" And I know the answer to that question. The Lamb. "And there was given unto him," verse 5, "And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. And power was given unto him to continue 42 months. Oh yeah, Satan's kingdom has an alarm clock. It has a time limit. Verse 6, "And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name." I wonder if that's what this Yeshua crowd is doing. "And he blasphemed his mouth, and he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations." Do you know what it means to be overcome? It means to be killed. "And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them." Their physical lives are going to be taken away from them. "And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him." Who? Worship who? The dragon, the beast. "And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. You see, Christ was to be the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. The way I see it, he was to be sacrificed before the Lord even created the earth. Verse 9. If any man have an ear, let him hear. All right, let's go back to Isaiah chapter 53. Chapter 7. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken, and he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many. Wow. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many. For he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Boy, that can preach. Boy, that can preach. Let's go back to Matthew 16:21. And from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. In the book of Luke, chapter 24 and verse 46. And he said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer, and to rise from the dead the third day. In Acts chapter 3 and verse 18. But those things which God before had showed by the mouth of all his prophets that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled. All right, let's go to the book of Acts, chapter 5. I guess we're going to read verse 1. And for those of you that think God still winks at sin, listen carefully. But a certain man named Ananias and Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. So here it is. They sold something they have, and they kept part of the price, But yet they're telling the apostles, well, we sold this thing and we're giving you all the money, which was a lie. I mean, you know, if you sell a piece of land for $10,000 and you give the apostles $8,000, say, well, I'm giving you $8,000, but I'm keeping $2,000, you know. I mean, after all, it was yours, right? The Lord had given it to you. But what they were doing was, is they were saying, well, we're giving you all this, you know. So, and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? While it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. In other words, he died. When you give up the ghost, that means your spirit leaves. And gave up the ghost, and great fear came on all them that heard these things. And the young men arose, wound him up, and carried him out and buried him. You know, this is why people have trouble with English from foreign countries. Wound, W-O-U-N-D. Wound, W-O-U-N-D. You would take a wound and wound the gauze around it, right? Verse 7. And it was about the space of 3 hours after, when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto her, tell me whether ye sold the land for so much. And she said, yea, for so much. Then Peter said unto her, how is it that ye have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door, and shall carry thee out. Then fell she down straightway at his feet, and yielded up the ghost. And the young men came in, and found her dead, and carrying her forth, buried her by her husband. And great fear came upon all the church, and upon as many as heard these things. And by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people. And they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. So evidently, Solomon's porch was a part of the temple. And of the rest durst, that's basically Old English for dared. And of the rest durst no man join himself to them, but the people magnified them. And believers were the more added to the Lord, multitudes both of men and women. Insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at the least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. There came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks and them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they healed every one. Boy, you know, they didn't make, they. I guess, you know, the difference between these people and Benny Hinn is Benny Hinn goes on TV and does this, right? And these people were doing it at the temple, but it says that they healed every one, whereas there's a bunch of people in Benny Hinn's audience that are sick, that go to his little thing, and they don't get healed. Oh, but if you're up on the stage in front of the TV, well, praise the Jesus, I'm healed. You know, I'm still waiting to see Benny Hinn go to a children's hospital and heal all the sick kids and empty the hospital out. I'm still waiting for that. Benny Hinn, you listening? Do it, buddy. Show me. Verse 17. Then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation. What is indignation? Extreme hatred. And laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, "Go, stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life." What life? Eternal life, people. And when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest came, and they that were with him, and called the council together. This is the Sanhedrin. This is what the Jews are trying to put back together. Well, they have put it back together. And called the council together, and all the senate of the children of Israel, and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came and found them not in the prison, they returned and told, saying, "The prison truly found we shut with all safety, and the keepers standing without before the doors. But when we had opened, we found no man within." Now when the high priest and the captain of the temple and the chief priests heard these things, they doubted of them whereunto this would grow. Then came one of them and told them, saying, "Behold, the men whom ye put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people." Then went the captain with the officers and brought them without violence, for they feared the people, lest they should have been stoned. Yes, people, this is what the evil, wicked leaders need. They need to have the fear of God of the people. You know, if they would have gone against Peter and the rest of them, the people would probably have killed the Jewish priests. Verse 27. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council, and the high priest asked them, saying, "Did we not straitly command you that you should not teach in this name?" What name? Jesus, not Yeshua. Yeshua doesn't appear in the New Testament anywhere, people. "Did we not straitly command you that you should not teach in this name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, and intend to bring this man's blood upon us." Well, yeah, because you killed him. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, "We ought to obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye," who's ye, the Jews, "whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. Him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are his witness of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him." Boy, that doesn't sound good. "Whom God," and let's see, "and we are his witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him." Huh. So do we have to obey God to be given the Holy Ghost? That's how I see it. Read verse 32 on your own. Make up your own mind. "When they," who's they, the Jews, "when they heard that, they were cut to the heart and took counsel to slay them." Oh yeah, don't like the message? Kill the messengers. Works every time, right? It's what they did to the prophets. It's what they did to the apostles. Do you know that the Jews killed 10 of the 12 of the apostles? The only two that weren't killed at the hand of the Jews was Judas Iscariot, because he committed suicide, and John, who penned the book of Revelation. They're the only two that weren't killed by them. Verse 34, "Then stood there up one in the council, a Pharisee named Gamaliel,
I've read some of the writings of Gamaliel in the Talmud. The Talmud isn't 100% filth, but it's sort of like looking for a pearl in a garbage can full of rotten food. Gamaliel, actually, this guy, I actually respect this guy. I heard in legend that he became a Christian. I don't know. Then stood there up one of the council, a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a doctor of the law, and had in reputation among all the people, and commanded to put the apostles forth a little space. In other words, have them go stand over there, and I'm going to talk to you over here. And said unto them, Ye men of Israel, take heed to yourselves what ye intend to do as touching these men. In other words, pay attention to what you're going to be doing. Verse 36, For before these days rose up Theudas, boasting himself to be somebody, to whom a number of men, about 400, joined themselves, who was slain, and all as many as obeyed him were scattered and brought to naught. They were brought to nothing. After this man rose up Judas of Galilee in the days of the taxing, and drew away much people after him. He also perished, and all, even as many as obeyed him, were dispersed. And now I say unto you, refrain from these men, and let them alone. For if this counsel, or if this work be of men, it will come to naught. So if the what the he's saying, if the apostles are if these apostles are what they're doing is just of men, what they're doing is going to come for nothing. Verse 39. But if it be of God, ye cannot overthrow it. Lest haply ye be found even to fight against God. And to him they agreed. And when they had called the apostles and beaten them, oh yeah. And to him they agreed. And when they had called the apostles and beaten them, who did they beat? The apostles. They commanded that they should not speak in the name of Yeshua. No, that's not what my Bible says. They commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus. Jesus! And let them go. They commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Now you know why the Yeshua crowd doesn't like the name of Jesus. And they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing. Rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. And daily in the temple and in every house they ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. Amen to that, people. Acts 5:41, and they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. In the book of Romans, chapter 8, verse 17, And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. Do you know what an heir is? Heir? That's somebody that is stands to gain from an inheritance. When a father dies and leaves a will and makes his children heirs, they inherit what their father had. Less, of course, what the state steals, but you know. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Didn't we just read that God gives the Holy Spirit to those that obey? How about 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12? Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. See, if you don't live godly and you don't obey, I mean, everybody wants Christ as a savior. But they don't want Christ as king. They don't want him as Lord. And let me tell you something. Every king has a kingdom, and every kingdom has laws. So you can either go by God's laws, or you can have the other guy. Choice is yours. I don't care either way. I'm just a messenger, basically. And I'm not claiming that I'm sent of the Lord. I'm not claiming that at all. I'm just somebody that reads the book. That's it. Acts 26:23. That Christ should suffer, and that he should be the first that should raise from the dead, and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles. Turn to Acts chapter 9. Ooh, this is a good one. All right, let's go to Acts chapter 9. Saul. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughters against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest, and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. Do you know where Damascus is? It's in Syria. There were Christians in Syria, Damascus. And the president of Syria, Al-Assad, I think his name is, he's having a fight of his life against ISIS. You know, it's funny, ISIS only attacks Christians and Muslims, and yet supposedly they're against the Israelis. But yet, you never hear about ISIS attacking the Israelis. There are some that says ISIS is Israeli Mossad, their secret service, their secret police, they're sort of like our CIA. Wouldn't surprise me. It's funny. ISIS has never attacks Israelis. They only attack Christians, and they only attack Muslims. Matter of fact, when ISIS got through with the Christians in the cities they captured, they find mass graves. Who does the Bible say killed Jesus and the Christians? I don't know if you ever saw the movie Casablanca, where the French-Moroccan police chief said, oh, round up the usual suspects. Oh, yeah. Verse 3. So, all right, so Saul is, he wanted letters from the synagogue, going to Damascus for the synagogues, that if they find any Christians in the synagogues teaching Jesus, that they might arrest him and bring him to Jerusalem. Verse 3, and as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth, and heard a voice saying, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Yeshua? No. And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he trembled and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? See, Saul was persecuting Christians. But you know what? He thought he was stamping out heresy. Because the Bible, believe it or not, the Old Testament says to kill false prophets. He thought he was doing God's service. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, arise, and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man, but they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither did eat nor drink. Remember, Jesus was raised up on the third day. Saul was 3 days without being blind, no sight. And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias, and he said, Behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, Arise, and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth, and hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in, and putting his hand on him, that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many that of this man, how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priests to bind all that call on my name. But the Lord said unto him, Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. See, it says, Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Saul was a chosen vessel. Did Saul choose the Lord? Or did the Lord choose Saul? And if you believe that the Lord chose Saul, and you start talking about election and being chosen and all that stuff, well, the people in the who drink milk, the milk of the Bible, well, they'll call you a Calvinist. God forbid that you believe that God has a chosen people. What can I tell you? Well, you can believe in God having a chosen people, but they have to be unbelieving Jews. Verse 17, And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way, as thou camest, hath sent me, that thou mightest receive thy sight, and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes, as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith, and arose, and was baptized. And when he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus. And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God. But all that heard him were amazed and said, Is not this he that destroyed them which called on this name in Jerusalem, and came hither for that intent, that he might bring them bound unto the chief priests? But Saul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. And after that many days were fulfilled, the Jews took counsel to kill him. The Jews took counsel to kill him. You don't like the message? Kill the messenger. But their laying await was known of Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. Then the disciples took him by night and let him down by the wall in a basket. And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he essayed to join himself to the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and believed not that he was an apostle. I'm sorry, that he was a disciple. So the Lord said in Acts 9:16, "For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake." In Romans 8, in verse 17 and verse 18, "And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Now, Paul wrote the book of Romans, and you didn't know he was a Southerner, did you? "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Yeah, he's reckoning. And I got nothing against Southerners. Hey, I was born in Kentucky. Kentucky was part of the Confederacy. Not that I'm for slavery. I'm not. I hate slavery. And believe me, I wish they would have repatriated all the slaves back to their native land. I do. Philippians 3 and verse 8. "Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ." If you don't know what dung is, watch a cow taking a dump. You know, the opposite end of where it eats. Never mind. All right. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Let's start in verse 14. "For ye, brethren, became followers of the churches of God, which in Judea are in Christ Jesus. For ye also have suffered like things of your own countrymen, even as they have of the Jews." Even as they have of the Jews, "who both killed the Lord Jesus and their own prophets, and have persecuted us, and they please not God." And they please not God, "and are contrary to all men, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved, to fill up their sins alway. For the wrath is come upon them to the uttermost." Who's the wrath upon? The Jews. To the uttermost. Because they killed the Lord Jesus, they killed their own prophets, they persecute us, and they please not God. And the church has suffered at their hands. You still think ISIS is a bunch of Muslims that kills Christians and Muslims? No. Absolutely not. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 9. And verse 10 also. "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels." How was Jesus made a little lower than the angels? He was God in the flesh. He was made human. Right now, we're a little lower than the angels. "But we see Jesus, who was made." And the Jehovah's Witnesses will point, see, Jesus was made. He had a beginning. He had a beginning. He's a created being. Well, you've got part of it right. Jesus was made flesh. But he existed before the world began. Didn't we read that? He was the Lamb of God slain before the foundation of the world. Yes, his body had a beginning. In the womb of the virgin named Mary. So when the Jehovah's Witnesses hit you with that stuff, I would tell you to tell them to go to hell, but they don't believe in hell. They will 5 minutes, 5 seconds after they die, and 5 minutes, and 5 years. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. For it became him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Book of James, chapter 5, verse 10. Take, my brethren, the prophets who have spoken in the name of the Lord for an example of suffering affliction and of patience. Oh yeah, the prophets. Do you know the prophets? Almost all the prophets were killed for their message. And who killed them? Israel and the Jews. They didn't like the message. Kill the messenger. Let's kill him. We don't like what he's saying. 1 Peter, verse 1 and 11. Searching what, or what manner of time, the Spirit of Christ, which was in them, did signify, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. 1 Peter 3 and verse 18. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust. See, Christ was the just. He never sinned. He's God in the flesh. He never sinned. And who's the unjust? Me. You. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh. See, Christ was put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. See, the Jehovah's Witnesses will deny what Christians call the Trinity, or the triunity of God. Father, Son, Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. But what they don't understand is God made man in his image. And God gave man a body, a soul, and a spirit. Let's see, body 1, soul 2, spirit 3. Man has 3 parts, body, soul, and spirit. So why can't God, who made man in his image, which is 3 parts, why can't it be Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit? Why not? You see, they tell you they're students of the Word, but they're not. They're students of Satan. And sadly, God blinds their eyes because they dishonor Christ. Jesus was God in the flesh. And yet the Jehovah's Witnesses want to push him down and say, oh, he was just an angel. Well, so was Satan. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. 1 Peter 4 and verse 13. But rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. that interesting? 1 Peter 3:14, but, and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, you see, if you don't live in righteousness, you're not going to suffer. But, and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. Verse 15. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. You see, when people think Christians are a bunch of idiots because they're happy, they bad things happen to them and they're happy about it. But we're supposed to give an answer to every man. When they ask, you know, what's this hope that's within you? And we're supposed to do it with meekness and fear. Verse 16. Having a good conscience that, whereas they speak evil of you, as of evildoers, that they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. Now, some people will tell you the spirits in prison are the fallen angels that were locked, you know, in the bottomless pit or whatever. I don't know. I don't believe that. I believe the spirits in prison were all the Old Testament saints. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the 12 tribes of Israel. All, you know, they're those that were followed the Lord. Because, let's face it, they didn't go to heaven. They were still sinners. King David. So what did Christ do? He went down. What do you think Christ was doing for the 3 days that his physical body was dead? Here it is, people. By which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. Read the study I did on Abraham's bosom. You know? Jesus went to hell, into Abraham's bosom, which was a special compartment in hell. It wasn't hellfire, it wasn't torture. And he preached unto the spirits which were in heaven and said, believe on me. But that's a whole nother study. By which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometime were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing, wherein few, that is, 8 souls, were saved by water. Did you catch that? 8 souls were saved by water. Do you know the flood of Noah was the salvation for the righteous? And it was judgment and wrath upon the wicked. Verse 21. The like figure whereunto even baptism... Ooh, baptism. Yeah, the earth was baptized in the days of Noah, all right. The like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is gone unto heaven and is on the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him. Oh, yeah. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 1. Forasmuch then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin. 1 Peter 5 and verse 10. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, oh yeah, in this life we're going to suffer. After that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. 2 Timothy 2 and verse 12. Listen carefully. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. And we're not talking about this water coming, falling from the sky to water crops. You know, when you're talking about reigning, that means to rule. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. Listen carefully. If we deny him, he also will deny us. Do you know that there are church people that will probably, in all likelihood, deny Jesus to save their lives? And Jesus said if we deny him, that he would deny us. In Matthew 10:33, and before you start arguing about eternal security and once saved, also saved, I suggest you listen to the words of Jesus and believe him instead of some Baptist preacher with his little man-made theology. Matthew 10:33, but whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father, which is in heaven. Ask yourself a question. Do Jews deny Jesus Christ as Messiah or the Christ? Absolutely. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father, which is in heaven. I think that puts a nail in the coffin, don't you? Now that's Jesus. That's not Paul's writing. That's Jesus. So in 2 Timothy 2:12, if we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 4. For verily, when we were with you, we told you before that we should suffer tribulation. What is tribulation? Trouble. We told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass, and ye know. 2 Corinthians 1 and verse 6. We're getting close to closing out this Bible study. And whether we be afflicted, what does it mean to be afflicted? If somebody takes a whip and beats your back, you're afflicted. And whether we be afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation. It is for your consolation and salvation. You ever heard of a consolation prize? You've heard, you know, you go in a contest and somebody wins the grand prize, but you didn't make it. But you get a consolation prize. That means you still win something. You just didn't win the big one. It is for your consolation and salvation, which is effectual in the enduring. Which is effectual in the enduring of the same sufferings which we also suffer, or whether we be comforted. It is for your consolation and salvation. 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 13. There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you. Now, sometimes when you read the word suffer, it usually means allow. It's an old English expression that means to allow. When Jesus said, thou shalt suffer the little children to come unto me, that means allow the little children to come to me. For of such is the kingdom of heaven. I'm paraphrasing, I think. But if you read about suffering, well, it's funny, God allows it. So I guess suffering has a double meaning there, right? But God is faithful, who will not suffer or allow, who will not suffer you to be attempted. Above that, ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. In plain English, people, that means God will not allow you to suffer something, persecution, more than you can bear. Now, you might, the way to escape it might be your death, but he will not allow us to be tried and tested above that we are able. And after all, Christ came in the flesh. Christ was God made in the flesh. He suffered cold. He suffered heat. He suffered thirst. He suffered hunger. He suffered being tired. I'm sure he endured sexual temptation, just like every man, probably almost every man has. You know, some would say that's blasphemy, but he was fully human. I'm sure he had all the same problems in the flesh that every man has, and some of the same ones that women have. In Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10, we're the Lord speaking to the church. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried. Ye shall have tribulation, trouble, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. And 1 Peter 5 and verse 10. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. Well, all blessings, praise, glory, and honor to the Lamb of God slain before the foundation of the world, and that's Jesus, who is the Christ. In his precious name, amen. This is Chaplain Bob signing off.